Well, good morning, everyone. I have something to share with you this morning. We're going to talk about faithfulness. I know it's not something that's exciting, the thought, things like healing and deliverance and all those things are exciting, but there are things that have as much, if not more, value in the kingdom of God. And that's what we're going to look at this morning, and faithfulness. And we'll look at what that means. I think the heart of what I really want to say is the idea of being a person of your word. Being a person of your word. And when you say something, when you say, I'm going to be there, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, that you do it. And you do it when you say you're going to do it. A number of years back, I had a drywall business for a number of years. And this was, I don't know, several years ago. I'm not sure why in this time period, it was like a period of about 6 months, I had three or four different customers that I had not worked for before. And when I settled up, I'd done the job, and they were paying me. They gave me more than what was asked, or what the price was. And I asked each one, I wanted to know. So, okay, well, I appreciate it, but why? I wanted to know. And you know what? Every one of them said exactly the same thing. Here's what they said. I said, why did you give me more than what I asked? She said, because you came when you said you would. And you did what you said you would do. Now, in their minds, and a lot of people's minds, that's something way up here, when really it should be the fundamental thing that you walk on. That should be the least, that you are a person of your word, and so much more if you're a believer, that you do what you say. And you do it when you say you're going to do it. If you say, I'm going to be there at 6:30, you should do everything you can to be there at 6:30, not 6:40, 6:45. But to be there when you say, do what you say you're going to do. It's a big deal. Let me ask you, anybody that's had a business and had employers, what are you looking for? What's the thing you want most? You can teach them how to do the thing you're doing, right? You can teach them that. But what you can't teach them, but what you're looking for is faithfulness. Hang on a minute. I have to lay this down to get these open. Probably won't use them, but I want to have them out here. All right. Let me just throw some words at you, just some synonyms for this word of faithfulness. Dependability. Can people depend on you? Reliability, basically the same thing. Loyalty. That's a big one, isn't it? Loyalty. Devotion and trustworthiness. That's what I think of when I think of this, being trustworthy. Can you be trusted? Not just when everybody's around you, when everybody sees you, but can you be trusted in private? Are you faithful when nobody's looking? When nobody knows? Because there's a lot of things you could do, nobody would ever know, and it really won't hurt them, but are you faithful? It's amazing to me how many people don't think anything about it. Say, yeah, I'll be there. And don't come. And don't even tell you they're not coming. That baffles me. How can you do that? Or come an hour later and don't think anything about it. It's sad. A lot of employers today, they're having such trouble. I hear it all the time. They're having so much trouble finding employees. One, nobody wants to work. And then when they come, they want to come when they want and do what they want to do. It's amazing. But listen, if you're a believer, you have a much higher standard. You realize that the God that you serve is a God, one of his premier attributes is that he's faithful. You can depend upon him. You can rely upon him. Listen, if he said it, he'll do it. If he's spoken it, he'll make it good. You can count on that. You can take that to the bank. You don't have to wonder if he's going to do what he said. And listen, you and I, our salvation, its goal is to conform you and I to the image of the Son of God, whose name is faithful and true. He has many names. One of his names in the book of Revelation is faithful and true. Not only is he faithful, but he's true. True, what's that mean? It's the word for authenticity. He's the real deal. What you see is what you get. He's real. He's authentic. Those qualities God is looking for in a people, that they're authentic. They're not a put-on, a pretender. They're this way around this bunch and this way around that bunch. If you live like that, you're not being true. Be true to who you really are. If you're born again, you're a new creation. Be true to that. Live from that. Don't be that here and then go somewhere else and be whatever, like a comedian, whatever they're doing there, you do that. So he's called faithful and true. Guess what? In fact, let's just look at this real quickly. Go to the book of Revelation and look. In Revelation chapter 1 and verse 5. Revelation chapter 1 verse 5 says, "And from Jesus Christ," watch this, "he's the faithful witness. He's the firstborn of the dead. He's the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loved us, or loves us, and released us from our sins by his blood." But look at the very first thing that it's given to him. He's the faithful witness. Now, why is he a faithful witness? Because he is the Son of God, but he became a man. And he was a faithful witness of who the Father is. He came to reveal him, and he was faithful to that. He said, "I don't do anything but what my Father's doing." He said, "I do always those things that please him." So much so that he said to one of the disciples who was wondering when he was going to show him the Father, he said, "Listen, when you've seen me, you've seen the Father." He's being true. He's being faithful witness of who God is. Would you say that? A faithful witness. And guess what? That's what he wants out of you and I. He wants us to become faithful witnesses of who he is. Not just what he does, but who he is. All right, look in Revelation 3:7. 3:7. "He who is holy, who is true." Talks about him being true there. Now go back to Revelation 19. Revelation 19 and verse 11. You realize that one day Jesus himself is coming back. We don't hear much about that anymore, but he's coming back, he's returning, and he's going to set up his kingdom on this earth. Most people are waiting to go to heaven and think that's where they're going to live. Listen, if you're in Christ, if you die right now, you will go to heaven, but that's not where you're going to dwell. Listen, in the resurrection, you're coming back to live on this earth. The new Jerusalem is coming to the earth. Heaven will be on earth. And you and I will live here to rule and reign with Christ. Watch this. Faithfulness is the pathway to ruling and reigning. It's the pathway to promotion and increase. If you want increase in your life, be faithful with what you have now. If you're looking for promotion into something higher, be faithful with what you've got now. Watch this. God sees it this way. If you can't be faithful with a little, he says, then I know you won't be faithful with much. Some people think that way, though. They think, if I just had more, I'd be more faithful. Understand, it really doesn't matter how you see it. It matters how he sees it. He says, if you can't be faithful with this little bit, forget it. No reason to give you any more. I can't trust you with it. See, we need to develop this quality in our life. Let me put this in a context. Most of you that's been here, I shared a series of messages here and then on a class on the garden of your heart. Every one of us has been given a garden, which is our heart, to do what? To cultivate and to keep. Let me tell you what, I did this on this premise. Here's the premise, is that when you come to Christ and you surrender to Him, to His Lordship, to put your faith in Him, you give Him your heart. He takes it, He cleanses it by His blood, He recreates it, and then He gives it back to you. But now, it's on different terms. Before, you were the supposed owner, but now you're the steward, entrusted steward of your heart. You gave your heart to Him, He received it, it's His, but He gave it back to you to cultivate and keep it. Most people, most believers don't even see that. They're waiting for God to do everything for them, to do things in their heart. Well, listen, you've been given the job to cultivate and keep your own heart. This quality of faithfulness is a heart quality. It's your job to cultivate and keep it. You're not going to wake up one day and be faithful. If you're waiting for that, you've got to say, whatever, coming. Because it doesn't work like that. But listen, here's the cool part. We can. Everybody in here can become faithful. You can be faithful. Just start being faithful in the little things, everything. Make it a repentance. It's a change of mind. When you make a determination, I'm no longer going to live like that. I'm not going to live in a compromised state. I'm going to be faithful regardless. Regardless of the cost. Now watch this. In the book of Revelation again, watch this. Back over in chapter 2, I believe it is. Alright, Revelation 2, remember, Revelation 2 and 3, there are seven letters to seven churches. Jesus sent these letters to these churches. Watch this, in chapter 2 and verse 8, He sends this letter to the church of Smyrna. But look in verse 10, do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to cast some of you into prison that you may be tested, and you will have tribulation in 10 days. But watch the next verse. Be faithful until death, and I will give you the crown of life. You want to know the extent of the faithfulness He expects or desires from you? Is that you're faithful to death. I told you this wouldn't be that exciting. But it's absolutely necessary. If you miss this, you'll be building on a faulty foundation. If you don't get this quality, this built inside of you, whatever you build will come back down in time. You can't build on anything else. All right, look down in verse 13. I know where you dwell, where Satan's throne is, and you hold fast my name and did not deny my faith. Even in the days of Antipas, this is Jesus speaking about Antipas, my witness, my faithful one, who was killed among you where Satan dwells. He calls him my witness, my faithful one. Here's one who was faithful unto death. Now, think about this. Think about Jesus in His humanity. He was faithful. You say, well, yeah, well, He was God, but what you may not understand is that He never, ever acted as God while He was on the earth. He never was not God, but He laid aside the prerogatives and the, privileges of Godhood or Godhead. Laid those aside to become a man. And He was faithful in everything. He was faithful. All right. Now, go to Proverbs with me, would you please? Chapter 20. This has been one of my favorite verses for many years. Chapter 20, verse 6. Chapter 20, verse 6. Listen what it says. Many a man proclaims his own loyalty, but who can find a trustworthy man? Listen again. Many a man proclaims his own loyalty, but who can find a trustworthy man? That last part is a question, but he's not asking the question. He's not looking for an answer. He's trying to incite a question within you and me. He's wanting you to see how valuable and how sparse and scarce is this quality of faithfulness. Look what it says. But who can find a trustworthy man? Now think about it. High value in heaven. Listen, heaven's value system is different, very different, than the values of the earth. That's why Jesus said, my thoughts are not your thoughts. They're so far apart as heaven is to earth. But in the values of heaven, this matter of being trustworthy and faithful is a huge, has huge value with God. Listen, many times we want to be in the limelight, or we want to do things that everybody gets to see. We like public ministry. We like to do the things that are exciting. And I do too. I like the exciting stuff. I like it. But listen, God is watching all the time when it's not exciting. In fact, that's where your trustworthiness and faithfulness is tested, when nothing's exciting, but you continue to be trustworthy. And you continue to be faithful when it doesn't matter, the people around you doesn't count. Listen, there's many things I could do, nobody would know, but I'm not going to do that. I've determined in my heart that I'm going to be faithful to God about these things. It's a quality that we need to see grown in our hearts and our garden. We can grow it. Now look in chapter 28 of Proverbs and verse 20. It says, a faithful man will abound with blessings, but he who makes haste to be rich will go unpunished. So a faithful man will abound in blessings. Listen, just because nobody sees it, God sees it, and he blesses that. He loves trustworthiness. He loves faithfulness, and he will reward it, even when nobody else sees it. Listen, I know a number of people I watch in their lives, and they're just faithful, just dependable. You can trust them. I never question it. And if they tell me they're going to do something, it's a done deal. I don't have to worry about it no more. Never think about it. Why? Because I know them. I know that I can trust that. If they said it, they'll do it. If they've spoken it, they'll make it good. That's a great quality we all need to have. Now look at this. Go over to Hosea, the book of Hosea. If you're in Proverbs, go to the right. Go through Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, Daniel, then Hosea, chapter 6. Hosea is a book about Israel's unfaithfulness to God, even though God loves her and is constantly trying to bring her back to him. She's constantly going away from him in apostasy, having many lovers, many idols, and so on. So look in verse 3 what God said. He's speaking to her about this. We'll read 3 and 4. So let us know, let us press on to know the Lord. His going forth is as certain as the dawn, and he will come to us like the rain, like the spring rain watering the earth. Now here it is, watch it. What shall I do with you, O Ephraim? What shall I do with you, Judah? For your loyalty is like a morning cloud and like a dew which goes away early. In other words, your faithful to me is just like the dew that comes on the plants. By when the sun comes up, it's gone. He says, your faithfulness to me is like that. But look down at verse 6. This is, if you don't hear anything else today, listen to verse 6. Listen to what it says. This is God speaking. He said, for I delight in loyalty. It's the same word for trustworthiness, dependability, faithfulness. He says, I delight in loyalty rather than sacrifice, and the knowledge of God rather than burnt offerings. So God's saying, I delight in faithfulness and you knowing me. In other words, it's this word for loyalty is a covenant word. It's the word if a person is entering into a covenant, that's what you're committing to. You're saying, I'm all in. We're no longer two, but one. I've got your back completely. I will be faithful to you, period. That's what you say when you enter a covenant. And that's the word that is used here. Hesed is the word. For I delight in, God says, I delight in this when people are trustworthy, they're dependable, they're faithful, rather than sacrifice. Sometimes it's much easier just to give sacrifice. The Pharisees gave sacrifices. They did it for show so everybody could see their spirituality. But God says, I delight in loyalty. When you're faithful, when nobody sees it. How do you think God chose David? Did he take a test? Well, he did, but not that guy. We don't see any other interaction between God and David. You remember that when Samuel went, God sent him to the house of Jesse to find him a man for a king, and he ran through all the brothers, remember? The first one that comes up, I forgot his name, Eliab, I think was his name, and Samuel said, this has got to be him, look at him. He's everything that you want. And God said, no, forget it. I've rejected him. He goes through every one of them. Here's David, little 13, 14-year-old boy. And God says, this is him. Why? He told you, right in the verse, it says, listen. He said, this is him because God does not see as man sees. Men look on the outward appearance, but God is looking on the heart. Listen, faithfulness is a heart issue. It's a matter of heart, and it's huge. Listen, guys, especially if you're just beginning in this and beginning to walk with the Lord, I would encourage you to develop. Do whatever it takes to develop this quality of being faithful and loyal. It is huge. Be a person of your word. People think it doesn't matter, but it does. You know, the thing itself might not be that big, but the thing is, you said. Right? It reflects on you whether the thing's a big deal or not. It does matter. Okay. 1 Corinthians 4:2. Actually, verse 2, but we'll read 1 and 2. Listen to what it says. It's Paul speaking. He said, let a man regard us in this matter as servants of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. In this case, moreover, it is required of stewards that one be found faithful or trustworthy. It's the premier quality that you look for in a steward. Why? What is a steward? You go back and look at the steward that was in Abraham's life. If you look at Joseph as a steward in Potiphar's house, listen, everything was under their hands. They put everything, he said, everything but what I eat is in your hands. You can do, you manage it, the king said. Now think about it. He's trust, remember that was the deal with Joseph and the king's wife. He said, I can't do this. Why? Because he was faithful, he was trusted with it. And so that's a premier quality that we look for in someone that's going to manage your affairs, what you say? Now, I don't know if you noticed this, but if you read the parables of Jesus, probably the greater portion of them is about this quality of faithfulness. Some of you will know this phrase, this will help. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Right. And you look at it, he says it over and over and over. He's saying things have been given into your hands. He's looking for faithfulness, that you'll take what he gave and you'll increase it. It's amazing. It's all there. He's looking for it. It says we've been made stewards over the grace of God, over the gifts of God that's been given to us. All right, let's do this, and I'm going to close because there's no reason to go on and on about it. I want you to get to one thing, just this one matter. Go to Luke 16. This is a parable of the at least what is called by the people who they didn't write the Bible. What would you call them? Never mind. Whatever that is. Whoever did that, commentary. Who wrote the commentary on it? They term this the unrighteous steward. That's not the point for us. I just want to see it's chapter 16, and it goes from verse 1 to verse 13. We're not going to read all that. All I want to do is extract three things about faithfulness. I want you to see them, because this is what matters. Look in verse 10. He who is faithful in a very little thing is faithful also in much. He who is unrighteous in a very little thing is unrighteous also in much. If therefore you have not been faithful in the use of unrighteous mammon, who will entrust the true riches to you? And if you've not been faithful in the use of that which is another's, who will give you that which is your own? You see that? Now watch this. You know what mammon is? Mammon is not money. It's the personification of money. It's like they're saying money is like this. It's like an idol is the point. It's the personification. So watch this. I just want you to see these three things. This is what God's after. Faithfulness in the little. Everybody can do that. He's looking for faithfulness in the use of your money. Do you spend it like it's yours? I know you say, well, I work for it, I get it, you work for it, but guess what's still his? It was here before you came. It's all his. But you're a steward over what's been given to you. So, over a little, over the use of money, do you steward your money right? And most of all, do you give? Do you give out of it? It's stewardship. It's being faithful. And Nick will talk to you about that. I let him work on that. Can you get it? Being faithful with the use of money. Now watch this thing. Here's one most people don't get. Being faithful with that which is another man's. Just let it soak in for a minute. Let's break it all the way down to the simplest. You borrow somebody's lawnmower, you bend the blade on it, and you take it back to them and give it back to them. You should always, whatever you borrow, you should always take it back in better condition than you got it. You say, well, why should, well, you don't have to. But if you want this quality of faithfulness, you will, because it matters. You're honoring the person who allowed you to use whatever it was. What about this in a church setting? You got vision that God's given you, but yet at this time He brought you somewhere to sit under someone else. Can you be faithful with their vision? Why? He says, if you can do that, then I'll give you the true riches. I'll give you your own. He's saying, because if you can't do that, you're not going to take care of the one I give you. Does that make sense? So three things, and then I'll close. And then where are you at? Just get this. Just let this sink in you. You don't hear anything else. Being faithful with the little. Everyday stuff. Being faithful. Two, faithful with the use of your money, your finances. And three, being faithful with that which belongs to another man. Can you do that? This is what the Lord's looking for. Now, whether you realize it or not, this not only matters in this age, but it's huge in the age to come. Now, what you may not realize is everything that you do now is determining your position in the age to come. I won't be able to stop. All right, let's just stop it right there. Let me pray over you. I just really hope that you can just get this matter of faithfulness. So, Father, I do. I just ask you, Lord, that God, that the seed that's been received, that, Father, that you would watch over it to perform it, that you would bring it back to their remembrance when they're alone. I pray that, God, in their daily routine, that when they're at that place of deciding whether to be faithful or not, that you would bring it back to their remembrance, Lord, remind them of this. And Lord, I pray that you would open up the scriptures to them and show them that what they do in this life, everything they do, everything they say, every motive of their heart will be judged and will be determined their place in the age to come. Lord, I pray for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Let me throw this to you as I go. I never saw this before. This is kind of new news for me. Most of you will recognize this verse where it talks about as it was, Matthew 24, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the day of the coming of the Lord. He said men were what? Eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, and they did not know or understand until the flood came and took them all away. Now, it used to baffle me. I thought, well, why would you even say that? Of course they were eating and drinking in marriage. Just the normal course of life. But what I believe he's saying is that's all they were doing. They were not sensitive to the time they were living in. They were only in tune with what you could see, hear, smell, taste, and touch. Many in the body of Christ are in the same place right now. Have spiritual eyes that you're not seeing. You have spiritual ears, but you're not listening. Listen, just like it was then, he says it'll be that way now. Just, we need to awaken to the time that we're living in. There's more to life than what you see, hear, smell, taste, and touch. So just keep that in mind. Okay. All right.
Okay. Guys, at the end of each time together like this, we always open up the opportunity for people to be prayed for, to be ministered to. If there's anything that's settled into your heart throughout this message, we'll have a ministry team up here and available to pray with you or to talk with you. If throughout this time of this gathering here today, there's something that's just been convicting or grabbing onto you, we want to talk to you about it. We want to walk alongside you in it. So please catch somebody that comes up to the front here, is on the ministry team. And otherwise, you guys are dismissed to go. Feel free to grab your kids out of children's ministry. If you're a teenager and you want to stick around for youth group, feel free to come over here and gather up front, and we'll get things started. Yeah. You guys have a good day. Love you.